Some people are going to dribble in. We've got 60 that are registered for today, but a few will probably join. Thanks so much for joining us today. I truly, truly appreciate you spending some time with us. I know there's a lot going on in the world right now. I also know there's a lot going on a personal level, especially this time of year. It's quite busy for most. This is Original Podcaster Brands 101 by Jar Audio. So we are Jar Audio. And again, thank you so much. To give you a really quick overview off the top, Jar Audio produces original podcasts for brands that make meaningful connections with audiences. And we're a full service agency. We do everything from podcast production, strategy, marketing, distribution, sound design with our clients. We do it absolutely all. My name is Roger Nairn. I'm the CEO of Jar Audio. I've spent the last 20 years in the advertising world working for big agencies like DDB and Cassette, and small agencies or mid-sized agencies like Spring and a few others in between. Being lucky enough to work with clients like Four Seasons, Netflix, Lamborghini, a lot of really great brands that love to tell great stories. I'm usually joined on these webinars with my sidekick, Paul Stewart. Unfortunately, Paul has just come down ill this morning, so he's not going to be able to join us today. Luckily, it's not COVID, it sounds like, but he unfortunately needs to, or fortunately needs to take some time and rest, but is unfortunately not going to be able to join us. Paul is our director of outreach. He comes from 25 years in business development with RBC on the finance side, recently with New Mode and EcoTrust, which are two fantastic organizations. So why should you listen to this webinar today? Jar Audio is one of the first to produce podcasts with brands, and we've been doing it for about 3 years now. Over that time, we've been lucky enough to work with some really great clients like Lululemon, Expedia, Cineplex, RBC. We'll share a little bit more of that later on, but let's get right into the details of the presentation today, because we get really excited about developing winning podcast strategies and execution. So we want to jump right in. Before I do, I just want to encourage anybody who has a question to please leave it in the chat function of the webinar. We're going to cover a lot today, so I might not answer your question right away, or I might say that bit's coming up, but please do not hesitate to ask any questions as we go about. I'm going to start off with a problem. You know, as marketers, actually, I'm a big fan of Seinfeld. So, I don't know if anyone's seen that episode of Seinfeld where Jerry goes into a car rental place and he says, anybody knows how to take a reservation? It's the holding of the reservation that's important. But as marketers, we know how to capture customers' attention. We rarely have problems with that. We just don't know how to hold their attention. And other than the sale, that's really the most important part of marketing is the holding. You know, these days, the cost of customer attention is on the rise. It's increasing year over year. It's even outpacing inflation. And when you receive this deck after the presentation, you'll see there's a great study by Harvard, which outlines those very things. But that then actually, you know, begs the question, what are we doing with our marketing dollars? We're filling that funnel. We have no problem filling that funnel. But there's a hole in that funnel for most of us. And you know, we keep filling and filling and spending tons of money to fill and fill and fill. It gets very expensive. It also gets very time consuming. And yet we still need to reach those customers. So we develop a lot of great content and we do a lot of stuff on the customer service side, customer experience side, and we do everything we can to earn their trust. And trust is obviously incredibly important. In fact, Edelman, in their latest trust barometer, said that those who highly trust the brands they purchase will reward them with loyalty, engagement, and advocacy. So do not want to discount trust at all. In fact, we want to increase trust, but it doesn't negate the fact that there's still this hole in the funnel. So what are we going to do? As marketers, what are we going to do? We have to retain the customer's attention. But then we also have to keep filling that funnel. We have to keep, you know, because we've got a hole, we've got to keep adding more and more and more. And that's where the podcast comes in. So I'm going to go over some very, very broad conversation around what a podcast is. Some of you may not know these things, but I'm sure a lot of you do. So when we talk about a podcast, we're talking about an episodic or serialized experience. It's typically in spoken word. always in audio, and is delivered in a digital format. The format itself, though, is shifting. So it was always mobile when it first started, but now we're seeing a lot more desktop usage. We're seeing a lot of usage in smart speakers. We're even accessing podcasts in our cars. It was always audio only when it started, but we're now seeing a blend of audio and video. I think Joe Rogan's a good example of the success of that. And typically when we first started in the podcast industry, episodes were physically downloaded to our phone. Now they're streamed as well. So both Spotify and YouTube have definitely increased the usage of streaming. And podcasts were typically always free, but we're also seeing some examples of gated podcasts where you're paying for premium content. Great thing about podcasts is the niche topics. You know, I'm really into comedy, so I love podcasts to listen to something that makes me laugh. But you might be interested in something that makes you a little bit scared or cry. There's a lot of great entertainment when it comes to podcasts, especially in the dramatic sense or crime. News is also a really popular niche topic when it comes to podcasting, especially these days. It's been quite a year. But also people love to learn. So there's a lot of really great opportunities to learn through podcasts. But the niche topics are really great because it allows you to create conversation and content around pretty much any topic. But what it has to be at the end of the day is really great content. You know, when it comes to content, people consume 3 to 5 pieces of content before engaging with sales or buying direct. We literally are all on the end of a big fire hose of content. Now, as marketers, you can keep pumping out that content, but very little of it is effective at getting customers to subscribe for more, nor is it habit forming. And this is one of the key reasons why brands are embracing podcasts today. The fact that you subscribe, you ask for more content, and you develop a habit around listening. You know, the listeners subscribe and they're forming that habit, and that's part of the actual act of listening to podcasts. For example, you could listen to an episode and at the end it might say subscribe to receive episode 2 in future episodes. Or you leave a little bit of suspense, you know, what's going to happen next? Subscribe to find out more. It's really baked into the podcasting listening experience. Which is why the big media companies are so into podcasts these days, and they have been for quite a while. You're seeing podcasts produced by Netflix. You're seeing podcasts produced by HBO or even the New York Times, Bell, Rogers, and Spotify. Disney's getting into the podcast game as well. And we actually were meeting with the New York Times last year, and in conversation with them, one of their executives said that he thinks in the next 3 years, all major brands are going to have a podcast. And we're starting to see that. You know, brands now act like broadcasters. They follow what the media companies know and have been doing. So we see podcasts coming from, new advanced companies like Tesla, but even more sort of traditional companies like GE. And this is where the branded podcast comes in. Now, a branded podcast is the exact same format as any other podcast. It just happens to be that the series is owned and produced by the brand itself. There's there's thoughtful mention of the brand inside the podcast. The topic itself is tangentially tied to the brand. It has to deliver a ton of value. And value can come in the form of being entertaining, helpful, or educational. But at the end of the day, it's just a really great podcast that just happens to be brought to you by a brand. Now, branded podcasts are great because they draw the audience in and then they get them to stay. That's going to increase the long-term value of that customer. That customer is then going to turn into an evangelist and is going to bring in more customers. They increase word of mouth, and that's actually going to drop the cost of acquisition overall. Because we're keeping them in that funnel. In fact, podcasting is now plugging the leak in that funnel by increasing retention. We're keeping them in there longer. So when we talk about a branded podcast, a couple things that we're not talking about is we're not talking about advertising on a podcast. We are huge fans of advertising on a podcast. It's a fantastic way to get the brand out there, but that's not what we're talking about. We're also not talking about rotating podcast sponsorships. So for example, you know, this episode of My Brother and Me is brought to you by MeUndies. That's not a branded podcast. In that case, that podcast is produced by a company named Earwolf, who produces My Brother and Me, and it's sponsored by MeUndies. Now, what we're talking about is, for example, MeUndies starting their own podcast. When we're talking about a podcast, the brand is developing original content and treating their customers like a true engaged audience. So again, the brand becomes the broadcaster. This isn't new though. I mean, when we talk about, this is content marketing, and content marketing has been around for generations, you know, going all the way back to when the Michelin guide was conceived. You know, the Michelin tire company wanted their customers to explore the French countryside more and drive more. So they created a really great guide of restaurants, and that's now known as the Michelin guide today. Don't know if everyone knows this, but Procter & Gamble came out with what we now know as the soap opera. And Ronald Reagan was the star of the General Electric Theater back when General Electric had, you know, all of their amazing products out in market. Now, when we talk about branded podcast, I mentioned this earlier, there's very little mention of the brand. You know, in an episode, we might mention the brand off the top. We like to do a midpoint rebrand. We'll probably mention the brand again. And then we'll mention the brand at the very end of the episode. At the end of the day, it's got to deliver a ton of value, and it can't really be about the brand itself. The story has to come first. Otherwise, it's just an ad, and nobody wants to listen to an ad for 20, 30 minutes. So here's a couple of really great examples. This is a podcast that was produced by General Electric. It's called The Message. It's owned by General Electric. So what it is, if you listen to it, it's a fictional sci-fi series about messages received from space. It's fantastic. It's really great. What it's not is it's not a show that has anything to do with their medical devices or aircraft parts. It's just a really entertaining piece of audio content. But what General Electric is getting is this amazing, brand halo effect, you know, because they're synonymous with invention and innovation. So it's really tied in nicely to their values. This is another example that our team at Jar Audio has produced with Expedia. So the podcast is called Out Travel the System. What it is if you listen to it, is it's a show that gives travelers a sneak peek behind the curtain, arming them with insider tips, tricks, and hacks for how to get the best out of their travel. What it isn't, it's not promoting Expedia deals. It's not, you know, trying to sell you at, you know, timeshare or trying to get you on a flight to Hawaii. But what happens when you listen to it is you get this really nice brand halo effect, because Expedia came to us and said, we have a challenge, and that is that we want to be known as a more helpful brand. So we want to create a podcast that just really helps our audience. And so we created the podcast using the data and the travel expertise that Expedia has to produce a podcast that's just chock full of value. So I've just talked about, you know, subscriptions and the actual like habit of listening to podcasts keeps listeners in that funnel for longer. But why else does a brand need a podcast now? I'm actually going to outline 10 more reasons and go into a little bit of detail with each. So the first reason is podcasts have a high engagement rate. You know, when you compare audio and video, it's really no contest, actually. With audio, with our podcast, we can only speak from our anecdotal evidence. From our podcast, we get listen rates of up to 90 to 99% of a 20 to 30 minute episode, which frankly is incredible when it comes to content. You know, the average YouTube video, for example, sees about a 50% watch through rate for a 60 second video. So what we're doing is keeping people listening longer, and we're keeping audiences more engaged. And we actually hear that a lot of similar branded podcasts get some of those high engagement rates as well. We actually think that there's no other marketing channel that has this high of an engagement rate. In fact, there's a study that came out from Westwood One, which will be included in the presentation link down below, that said that when it comes to the engagement value that audiences receive from different media, podcasts came in just under checking the news and checking the weather. It was right up there with listening to music. It was above watching videos and even posting on social. It's actually two times the engagement rate of social media. The second reason is that podcast listenership is frankly exploding. This is another study that was done by Edison Research. It's called the Infinite Dial. It's sort of the pinnacle of the sort of annual study on podcast listeners. It's estimated that there's 104 million listeners in the United States listening to podcasts these days. And actually, we originally, you know, saw it as a young person's game when it comes to listening. But over time, what we've seen is actually more the boomers as well getting into podcasts. We actually saw a huge climb in 2020. It definitely still skews younger, but we're starting to see more and more. And actually, the advertising market when it comes to podcasts, we're anticipating in 2021 is going to be a $1 billion industry. So we're definitely climbing up into what we would consider to be a regular medium when it comes to consumers. Now, Jar Audio also operates in Canada. So want to give you a little data on the Canadian podcast listener. Actually, Canada is neck and neck with the United States and has some of the world's highest listenership when it comes to podcasts. So reason number three, podcasts allow you to reach new audiences. Now, podcast listeners are more educated, they're more affluent, they're highly loyal to brands, and we'll go into a little bit more detail on that in a second. And actually, really interestingly, they spend more money on themselves. So it really gives you an opportunity to reach a unique audience, depending on your brand. Couple of great things about the audience as well is that they love to learn. They're heavy, heavy social users, and they are highly influenced when it comes to word of mouth. Reason number four, podcasts give you brand IP with compounding ROI. What I mean by that is that if you've got competition and you put out a podcast, you're then first to market, you know, in your category, and that helps fortify your competitive advantage. It's very difficult for your competitor to then come along and produce a similar podcast that's competing with you. It's just not going to really come across all that well. You're definitely going to come across as late to the game. And when you build up that large audience then becomes an asset that increases the company value overall. And the ROI compounds the larger it gets. When it comes to measuring ROI, which is a big question that we get with our clients, there's a number of different ways that you can measure ROI, just like any other form of content. There's brand metrics, you know, things like measuring awareness, you know, authority. I talked about earlier with Expedia, they wanted to increase their sentiment around helpfulness. There's consideration and purchase intent. There's then the web metrics, which we can track, which, you know, things like lead generation, site traffic, conversions, SEO. And then there's the podcast metrics. Now, there's the more vanity metrics like listens and downloads, which are obviously incredibly important. But then because this is a marketing medium, we like to talk a lot about the engagement level. So listen lengths, we can tell through the analytics, which we'll touch on in a little while, how long people are listening for, how long we've kept them listening for. And then there's the reviews, you know, some of that qualitative feedback that you get from your audience. Reason number five, podcasts are an intimate medium. So as a medium, podcasts have done what pretty much no other medium or even the internet has been able to do, which is create that level of intimacy with their audiences. When I say intimate, like right now, it's literally in your ear. It's like somebody's whispering a message into your ear, and you've created that relationship with that host. And they're talking to you every day or, you know, every week, and they're whispering something right into your ear. It's also catered to personal preference. You're choosing what content you want to be listening to. It's not like listening to the radio where it's just broadcasting whatever to you. You're actually saying and voting and choosing, I want to listen to this right now, and I want to take some time and pay attention and listen. It's also mostly done solo on your own time. Now, it's not to say you can't listen to a podcast with, you know, your housemate or your partner, but most listeners will listen on their own time. Reason number six, podcasts are portable. You can listen to a podcast in the car, on the bus, you know, on the subway, at the beach, walking your dog. I like to listen to a podcast while washing dishes or, you know, running on the treadmill at the gym. You could listen to a podcast while you're mowing the lawn, grocery shopping, working. There, you know, there's a lot of other mediums that are also portable, but there's very few that have this level of intimacy as well as this, you know, high engagement rate. And you can take it with you. You know, you can't really watch a video while bouncing around on a treadmill. It kind of makes you sick. At least it does for me. And actually, the portability of it and the consumption side of it is really interesting. There's a great study by BBC Audio called Actionable. It said that 94% of listeners consume podcasts while performing other tasks. And I'm sure many of you are quite similar at that. But the cool thing is that this multitasking mode of listening actually elevates the engagement of the brand. What I mean by that is this goes against pretty much everything we've been told from a marketing standpoint when it comes to different mediums these days, which was that too much clutter equals distraction equals lost messaging. It's a waste of money. But when you listen to a podcast and you hear brand messages, you're actually absorbing that message more. So essentially the marketing message comes in through a low involvement processing, which is a more fuel efficient way of the brain accepting information. So this multitasking that you're doing, washing the dishes, walking the dog, you know, going for a run, it actually improves the brand message cut through. And again, we're not talking about a 30 minute ad, but even the mention of the brand tied in with the entertainment you're getting from the show is making a huge impact. Reason number 7, podcasts are a pull medium. Now, what I mean by that is, you know, we've talked about this earlier, listeners subscribe to the content, so they're actively seeking it out and asking for more. You know, when they subscribe, they're saying, I really like this and I want the next episode when it's available, the next episode, the next episode. So they have an active interest in the information that's available to them. And they're investing their time. You know, in fact, Edison Research said that weekly podcast listeners spend an average of 6 hours and 37 minutes listening to podcasts every week. That's a lot for a weekly podcast listener. And in the case of a branded podcast, that's a long time, you know, with a relationship with a brand. Reason number 8, podcasts are great for internal communications. And what I mean by internal podcasts is it's produced by an organization and pushed out to their staff. It's not pushed out to the general public. It's just for the staff only or whoever's within the organization. So essentially what they're doing is they're creating a private link, hosting it on a private server and then pushing it only to their staff. Or they might put it behind an intranet, for example. Really great thing about this is that they're able to measure some of the analytics around who's watching it, who's listening to it, how long they're listening to it, and all sorts of different things. So this is a really great break from screen fatigue during the pandemic. You know, we've all been staring at our laptops quite a bit. Typically, communication within an organization, especially these days when we can't all see each other in an office, is done through emails and internet. But frankly, that's a very one-dimensional medium. It's, you know, it's quite boring at times. Audio allows you to, you know, add in a little bit more emotion and you can really tell and feel what the person is saying. It's delivered in a format that staff embrace on their own time. The internal podcast that we produced, we've heard some anecdotal evidence that people like to turn it on while they're getting ready for work or brushing their teeth or doing their hair in the morning or driving into the office. It's great for culture building, onboarding, and development. We produced an internal podcast for Lululemon that was then pushed out to their 3,600 staff all across the world who were frankly unhappy with the fact that they felt a bit disconnected from head office. And so we pushed it out to them and it felt like they were a part of the larger team, which is great for culture. And it's delivered in a conversational style. There's really no sort of rules when it comes to, you know, how you produce it and what you can say. In fact, podcasts are a flexible medium, which is number nine. You're not constrained by many rules. You know, you can have a podcast that's as long as you want. You know, the Joe Rogan podcast is upwards of 3 hours. That's too long for me personally, but there's really no rules to that. You're not constrained by a 30-second, you know, ad slot in, you know, on TV or the radio, or a 60-minute slot on YouTube, or sorry, 60-second slot on YouTube. Same with the format. You can have a one-to-one conversation. You can have a roundtable discussion, or it can be a lot more of a sort of a documentary style. We'll go into a little bit more of that in detail. You're not constrained by ad standards, which anybody who comes from the advertising world knows can be a challenge to navigate. You can talk about any topic, and the shelf life of your episodes can last quite a while. In fact, we have ways of dynamically inserting content into episodes to keep them fresh without having to take them offline or completely redo them. And if anyone's ever produced a video and had to make edits, it can be quite time consuming. You got to get the lighting right. You got to get everybody's continuity when it comes to the, clothing and all that sort of stuff. And then you've got to be able to seamlessly insert it into the video. It's not easy. It's quite expensive. The final reason is that podcasts have continued through the pandemic. Audiences still want to be entertained. They want to learn a new skill now more than ever, because unfortunately so many people have lost their jobs, or they want to escape. And podcasts allow you to escape, allow you to be entertained and teach you new skills. And I absolutely believe that a brand has every reason to be able to deliver that. There's no reason why they can't be in that world as well. When it comes to the actual logistics side of it, we record at Jar Audio, we record all of our podcasts remotely. We have since the inception of the company. We've got a technology that we send out to all of our guests and hosts. It's a kind of plug and play system where they get a professional microphone and they plug plug a cord into their wireless router, and it connects to our server, and we can essentially mimic a studio quality recording session, all done remotely. So those are 10 reasons about why brands are embracing podcasts. You might be thinking to yourself, this is great. I want to get started. Let's get one going for our brand. We think it's really important to ask yourself three questions though, before you really go down that road. The first question is, how can you deliver value to the listener? It's all about the listener. This is the absolute most important thing to consider when developing a podcast. So you need to ask yourself, what does our listener need? What do they care about? What are they listening to? What are their online habits? All these things that chances are you've done a lot of this sort of thought around your audience already, but it's really, really important. What can you teach your audience? How can you help your audience? How can you entertain your audience? One of the questions that we like to ask our clients when we sit down for our strategy sessions is, what does the world need most that you are most qualified to talk about? And then create a podcast around that. The second question is, are you the right type of brand? What I mean by that is, as a brand, you need to have a level of creative bravery, because if you're not creatively brave, you're not pushing the boundaries of producing great content. And if you're not producing great content, frankly, your podcast isn't going to be listenable. And if it's not listenable, then you're not going to get that great engagement rate. And if you don't get that great engagement rate, then as a marketing medium, it's going to be a waste of your time and money and effort. It also needs to absolutely be focused on the audience. You need to constantly be asking yourself, is this right for audience? Is this right for audience? And of course, you need to just deliver a ton of value. And then the third question you need to ask yourself is, are you prepared to deliver consistent quality? And when I say quality, I'm talking a high production value, the right host, the right music, that could be custom or it could be needle drop. Do you have multiple scenes in an episode or the show? And when I say multiple scenes, it's actually a strategy to increase engagement. So if you break up the episode by maybe switching topics, or maybe introducing a new voice or an interesting interview that kind of cuts in and goes a little deeper on a certain topic, what it does is it keeps the listener's brain engaged. It keeps them listening. And the longer they listen, as we know, the higher the engagement rate and the more successful as a marketing medium the podcast is going to be. So when we're producing shows, we're asking ourselves, like, at what point am I dropping? Is my brain maybe dropping out because we've been rambling on for 5-10 minutes and we need a bit of an interjection of some sort? And one of the ways to also do this is through really well-crafted storytelling that takes some twists and turns. So if you're confident and you think this is right for you, let's produce a podcast ourselves right here on this webinar. This is going to show you what we think it takes to deliver a great podcast. And we go through five stages or phases when we develop a podcast. And these are the same that you can do yourself with your own organization. First step is prepare, then produce, then push, then promote, and then pull. So let's go through prepare. Prepare is really just a fancy way of saying strategy. So again, we need to sit down and ask ourselves, you know, who is this audience? Because it's got to be the audience first. We need to ask ourselves, what's their age, sex, location, interests, social habits, topic interests, podcast interests. And as marketers, a lot of this is probably information that you already have. You then also need to ask, what are their expectations and needs? So what do they need to learn? Where do they need help? How do they want to feel when it comes to listening to our podcasts? You're then going to look at the brand. You're going to look at your brand and you know, you probably are very clear on what your brand values are, but what does your brand have to offer? Again, what does the world need most that you are most qualified to talk about? And then you're going to take your audience and your brand and you're going to put them together. And in between, you're going to be able to find the right podcast to produce. So let's create a podcast together. Let's pretend like we're creating a podcast for the brand Indeed. For those that don't know, Indeed is an online job search site. You know, as we know, there are unfortunately a lot of people who are out of work due to the pandemic. So companies like Indeed are great resources to find new work. But let's pretend like we're aiming at a group of people that have lost their job and have perhaps not been in the job market for a very, very long time. So let's pretend like this audience is in their mid 40s and up. They've been in management before. They've been in that industry that they're working in for a very long time. We would consider them to be an infrequent but valuable user. So let's pretend like they're gonna get back into a management position. They're eventually going to need to hire more people as the economy grows back. So they would maybe come to Indeed to post future jobs. So we would consider them to be infrequent but valuable. So what are some of the expectations and needs of this person who's looking to get back into the job market? You know, they might be expecting to be behind the pack when it comes to job search, entering the job market for the first time in a very long time. And perhaps they need to be reskilled because they haven't learned some of the new things that they might need in order to be competitive in the job market. We're then going to create a persona around this person. And I know everyone on the call is probably very familiar with creating personas, so I won't go into this in detail. But we're going to create a person of who this would be. So in this case, we're creating a persona around a person named Kent, and he's 46 years old. We're then going to take the values of Indeed. The values of Indeed are integrity, respect, leadership, personal growth, excellence, and stewardship. When it comes to our persona, Kent, there are four values that I think line up really nicely with producing that are going to help with producing a podcast. It's integrity, respect, personal growth, and stewardship. And with Kent, this is what we're solving for. He needs to be taught. He needs help getting back into the workforce, and he needs to be entertained. So then we're going to develop some concepts. We're going to come up with a bunch of ideas, going to put those up on the wall. We're going to really be ruthless about whether these are right for Kent. But ultimately, we've landed on a podcast idea, which is a podcast that tells the inspiring stories of men and women who have made career changes during less than ideal times. What did they do? How did they do it? How did it turn out? We love that idea. We think it's great to make a podcast out of, but we need to make sure that it's right for Kent. So we're going to vet the idea against Kent, the persona, and we're going to be ruthless. We're going to ask ourselves, would Kent listen to this podcast? Is it useful to him? Is it entertaining? Would he talk about it? Would he get bored? Would he look forward to the next episode? Because that's really important. We want him coming back. Is he going to share it with friends? Yes. Turns out that Kent is going to love it. We think that Kent is the right audience for this as well. And we're really going to be able to help Kent out. So we're going to create a podcast. And we've just created a podcast. It's called Pivot and Pursuit, a podcast by Indeed. Inspiration on your career change journey. New episodes come out weekly. It's great. It doesn't exist, but it's great. So it's brought to you by Indeed. There's a nice connection between them. We're then going to get into some of the nitty gritty. We're going to look at the guest strategy. Who are some of the guests that we can have on the show that Kent's going to really be attracted to? We're going to look at the season arc. You know, how, you know, if we're looking at season as 6 to 12 episodes, how are we going to map out those 12 episodes so that they, you know, bring the listener along and keep them engaged over those 12 episodes? And then we're going to ask ourselves, what's the best story format to serve Kent as well? When we talk about story format, there's mainly sort of three different formats that we consider. The first is interview-based, and this is where, you know, in-depth interview with sculpted question lines that really get under the hood on a certain topic. There's then the narrated format. This is kind of if you turn on, if you listen to the radio on a Sunday morning and listen to NPR or CBC, that's sort of the format where it's kind of documentary style, great format. And then the third is probably the least used, but we think one of the best opportunities is sort of the fictional science fiction format. And a great example is this this podcast on the right, which is called Blackout. It was starring Rami Malek, fantastic show. And it just happens to be brought to you by Sonos. Really, really sonically crisp and amazing to listen to. But when it comes to Pivot and Pursuit, we're going to choose the narrated format. We're going to tell stories with a narration over the clips. We're going to, you know, provide the listener with on-scene textual recording and then really great, excellent music set to a certain tone and you know, shift the focus and mood throughout the episode. Great. So that's our prepare stage. We're now going to produce this podcast, Pivot and Pursuit. We're going to do research on our guests. We're going to understand who they are and where the opportunities are for conversation. We're then going to craft really great scripts and question lines for the host. We're going to hire that host as well. We're going to find the right host and make sure that this is somebody that Kent would really be attracted to. We're obviously going to record, but then we're going to get into the edit where we do our sound editing. We're also going to, you know, find the right stock or custom music and apply it to the episodes. Throughout all of this, you have to be absolutely ruthless. You have to continue to vet each stage as you go through. Is this the right host? Are these the right guests? Is this going to be the right music that he's interested in? Is the pacing of the episode going to be worth his time as well, or is it going to keep him engaged? Now, depending on the format, a 6-episode season should take roughly about 2 months to produce the first 2 episodes. We like to at least launch with a couple episodes in the bag. That gives us a little bit more runway to focus on the next episodes. And then once the show has launched, we release an episode every 1 to 2 weeks. There's really no rule when it comes to the release cadence. 1 week, 2 weeks, could be every day if you want. What's important is to keep it consistent for the listener so that they know what to expect. You know, if you're going to launch your episode monthly, you know, set that up for them. Make sure that they understand that that's the expectation and that's when they should expect to listen to episodes. The third phase is push. And this is where the podcast gets pushed out to the world. And this is actually interesting. One of the biggest concerns that we hear from brands is they assume that it's very difficult to make sure that the podcast gets sent to Apple and gets sent to Spotify and gets sent to Google and everywhere. You know, it's actually quite simple. We use an online host server. In our case, we mostly use Omni Studio, but there are all sorts of great options out there. And this online host server essentially acts as our central command control to push all the podcasts out to the different directories, as well as it hosts the, you know, the title of the show, the show notes, all the metadata that we need, as well as the artwork, and then the MP3 file as well. Once it's pushed out there, we then get access to all sorts of great analytics, reviews. It's also going to provide us with an embedded player that you can post on your website or a landing page, as well as social links to share the show. I'm going to go in a little bit more detail on that in a bit. You, of course, need to promote the show, which is the fourth phase. It's not really the case anymore that you can put a podcast out there and it's going to go viral. You need to put some active effort into promoting the show. When it comes to promoting podcasts, we look at it from sort of a six bucket strategy. The first bucket is marketing. And this is where we're, you know, creating landing pages, and we're looking for partnerships and opportunities with different media companies and social platforms to drive to the show. The second area is PR and earned media. And this is where we're acting like publicists, essentially. We're going out to different media with a media kit, usually outlining who our host is, giving more detail on what to expect, you know, like creating a show synopsis, creating detail on who the guests are, what each episode's gonna look and sound like, and then giving them the opportunity to either interview our hosts or feature the show launch in an article. We're just trying to get as much coverage on the show as possible. The third area is what we call spotlighting. There's a big misconception that if you get featured at the top of Apple's, you know, sort of new and noteworthy, which is kind of the pinnacle of awareness of a podcast, there's a big misconception that you're somehow beating an algorithm to get up there. Turns out this is all decisions made by editors. There are real people who work at Apple Podcasts who make those decisions. It's not an algorithm, which means that you can physically pitch them on why you should be featured. There are editors divided up by country, and each of those editors then makes those decisions. They'll sometimes have different editors for different categories. They'll have a business editor or entertainment editor. And so you're able to tell them why your podcast is deserving of a bigger audience. You can even break it up into why your podcast should be featured in a curated list that you know, you've thought up of. Like with our Out Travel Assistant podcast for Expedia, you know, we were featured in, you know, the top 10 list of podcasts to listen to on a road trip. Or our Cineplex client was featured in a list on Apple to encourage people to watch movies during the winter as they're snuggled inside. It's really, there's really no rules for how you do it. The fourth bucket is cross promotion. And that's the kind of low hanging fruit when it comes to podcasts is other podcast listeners. So we're creating lists of other podcasts that Kent our persona might also be listening to. And then we're reaching out to them and pitching them on why we should have our guest our host on their show, for example, to guest in exchange for them coming on our show. Or even we'll say, here, you know, you post one of our episodes in your feed as a bonus to your audience. And in exchange, we'll do the same thing. The podcast world is quite friendly and still quite small. So you're able to reach out to anybody you want and make those sorts of pitches. The fifth area is paid promotion. We're not big fans of paid social when it comes to podcast growth, podcast audience growth. We find that you're not always hitting people when they're listening to podcasts. So it's a few steps away from getting them to subscribe to the show. But we are big fans of paid promotion on other podcasts or in podcast directories. So we're creating media plans and strategy to spend certain budget on hitting those shows. And then the sixth area is what we call the plus more buckets, and we need a better name for it. But that's where we're turning it over to the brand and saying, what are the own channels that you have, or what are so the what we call the sort of unfair advantages that you have within your organization, and let's leverage that. So if you're a bank, you've got a huge customer base or member base that receive emails from you all the time. Let's include the podcast link on an e-newsletter. Or if you're a nonprofit organization, you've got a really great volunteer list that want to hear more and engage with your brand more. So let's reach out to them. I've got a question here that I want to touch on. Jason has asked, do you have a list growth graph for a brand with the promo tactics mapped on the trajectory? Getting listeners feels like it could be the biggest challenge. Don't have a list per se, but it's very much dependent on how big of an audience you already have. So that's one area is we start out with, who are your existing followers? What does your existing audience look like? And then we kind of move back from there. It is the biggest challenge when it comes to the podcast audience growth, but if you're creating great content that is in tune and in line with what that audience needs, then it absolutely, goes a long way to helping with that. So it's the biggest challenge, but it's a lot easier when the show is tailored and produced with that audience in mind. Maybe we'll touch base after the call with a little bit more detail on that specifically. I've created a list of some examples of what we would do for Pivot and Pursuit, but I'm not going to go into those details just for timing's sake, but it's going to be included in the deck. The one thing to also remember when it comes to promoting your podcast is you need to think about the ecosystem around the podcast itself. I'm a design guy, so I like to think a lot about kind of the look and feel and consistency of the brand around the podcast. So we need to consider things like the artwork, landing page or a microsite that you're going to drive traffic to for more information on a certain episode or guest, or to listen to the podcast itself. Social content, to promote the show, we still believe in social content and promoting the show through social. So you're going to want to talk about it. You want to create the right language, look and feel. You're also going to want to be consistent with your social links, which we can go, I'm going to go through in just a moment. What we think is really important is creating a very simple style guide just to keep everybody consistent when using promotion of the podcast and around the podcast. It also helps with anybody new who's coming in that's getting involved with the podcast as well. This is a very, 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 very simple landing page that we created, that I've created just for the presentation. But what we've done is taken the Spotify embed and we've just literally put it right in the page. So it gives listeners an ability. We've also created some very simple artwork, video, which will be in the deck as well. So the fifth and final category is pull. This is where, now that you've pushed it out to the world, you've promoted it, you're now able to receive all this data back, which is really, really exciting. Great thing about the data is that you can use that to inform future creative. So podcast is being pushed out to the world. You're seeing you're seeing all your downloads, your subscribers, what the reach is, you're reading all the reviews. You're able to see the demographics, age and sex, and also the location. Location is all the way down to the city level. And then you're able to see all the consumption data. It's telling you verified plays, the average time somebody's listening for, what the retention is, like how long, where are you dropping people off? Where are they starting as well? Some people start a podcast, a few minutes in. The drop-off point is really important because that's generally where you might be losing people. You maybe are boring them, or maybe the content just isn't sitting well with them. But that's all really great information that you can then feed to your team or whoever it is, or yourself for future episodes. Or maybe you go in and you fix that episode. There's no real rule for what you're doing. So that's pretty much the whole presentation. But before we go, I just wanted to give a quick little overview on who we are at Jar Audio. So our leadership team, myself and my two partners, we have experience building brands, producing engaging digital content, and telling compelling stories. But then we're supported by a really really big and huge and talented creative team. They consist of writers, recordists, sound editors, and audience growth strategists that blend journalistic integrity with audio expertise. I mentioned that we're full service, so we do everything from the strategy all the way to the analytics and analyzing all that data. Whatever we do, we're creative, collaborative, and fun. And I should mention that when we work with our clients, we're also quite flexible. So there might be some services that you and your team might be able to handle, and we're always willing to sort of treat it like a bit of a menu and take some things out. We like to stay collaborative as well. So really, really tight with our clients during the project. And we've been incredibly lucky. We've worked with great brands like Expedia and Cineplex, Lululemon, Royal Bank, Sage, Van City, Port of Vancouver. Plus, we have a lot of really exciting shows that are in production right now that are going to be released soon. Really, really big takeaway that we want you to get from this is that we're here to help. If you have any questions, please reach out to us. You know, of course, also check out the website. We're learning as we're going as well, because the podcast industry is changing daily. So we update our followers a lot on our blog about the things that we've learned. But if you're interested at all in producing remarkable podcasts, I've left the information for Paul, who's usually joining me on these webinars. Please reach out to him if you have any questions at all. We are more than happy to help, with anything. We're also really friendly people too. Does anybody have any questions before we turn off the webinar? I want to make sure we're answering any right here, but also if you do have any more questions, don't hesitate to reach out. I know Jason's asked one already. Does anybody else have any more? Please use the chat function. Doesn't look like anybody does, which means that everyone's, oh, there we got one. Tom has asked, how do you think about podcast as a mini brand within your company's core brand style, guide, and package? How do you think about podcast as a mini brand within your company's? Yeah, so it's just like any other form of content. You can either dial up or dial down the brand. How you brand the podcast itself is, I'd say, more important to brand it around what's right for the show and what's right for the audience. That is just tangentially tied back to the brands. So in the case of RBC, for example, which is a podcast that we do a podcast with them called that's called Disruptors. You'll see that maybe they use a little bit of the brand colors. There's a logo in the bottom right-hand corner of the artwork. But when you're listening to the show, there's very little mention of RBC at all. They never talk about the product, but it lives within the RBC website. It's tied, you know, style-wise and visually to the brand, but it's not sort of barfing it out. It's very, very light. Again, it's got to be about the brand. Sorry, it's got to be about the audience as much as possible. So whatever you think is right for the tone and the characteristics of the show, and you know, it's all dependent on what the idea of the show is as well. If anybody else has any questions, I definitely encourage you to drop it in the chat. We're all learning together. So Alex has asked, is this medium good for companies of any stage or better for more established businesses? As a startup, what kind of budget should we be allocating to produce a solid podcast, if not something amazing? Well, it should be something amazing, Alex. That's a great question. So we're big believers that it can be any stage of the organization. Again, going back to, you know, the audience, your audience is out there, whether they're already aware of the brand or not. So we actually think this is a great opportunity for awareness building. Again, great content draws a crowd. And so if you're creating great content and are marketing it properly, you're able to draw those people into the funnel. And so from awareness stage, great. But then even like lower down in the funnel from engagement, keeping them engaged, educated on a certain topic, or answering any questions they might have on a certain industry or an idea, the show can absolutely be about that as well. So it can be any stage in the growth of the company, but also the stage of the funnel as well. From a budget standpoint, so with Jar Audio, we budget based on the length of the show, And we actually price it out based on a per minute of finished audio standpoint. So we're roughly about $400 per minute of finished audio, which if you take like a 6-episode season comes out and about roughly 20 minutes per episode comes out to about $48,000. That's full service, and that's including everything actually except the marketing side of it. So we do marketing a bit separate. But again, what I would encourage you to do is really take an analysis of your other content and your spend on that and what it takes to, you know, to reach that audience. I know when we talk to clients and they talk about the expense of producing video, for example, it's quite a lot higher than that. But when you compare it to the engagement rate and the amount of time that you're keeping that audience in the funnel, the ROI is actually quite impressive, they find. And then when it comes to budget, you know, you want to make sure that there's a paid component as well, which I think is very much dependent on what's right for your brand and also the type of either podcast you're purchasing on or whatever medium that you're purchasing on. Again, everything's going to be dependent on what's right for the brand and the audience. Any last questions at all? All right, doesn't look like anybody has any more questions. So that takes us to the end. So thank you so much for spending your time with me today. Good luck, and of course, happy holidays. Thanks so much, everyone. Hope to talk to you all again. Appreciate it.